Fish on. This one's on a trolling fly. Oh, that's a nice fish. It's a dandy fish.
Ha-ha.
That's sweet. That is on a pink and white fly. Scrapper. Yeah, you know, rainbows love pink, and that pink and white marabou fly with those lead eyes, it has a very unique action, and man, that fish just crushed it. Oh, man. A lot of guys haven't tried trolling flies yet, but I'll tell you what, they are dynamite, especially when the bite is tough. This is Silverthorn Bay on Lake Shasta. Got a lot of fish in this area. Comes one tired out rainbow. Oh, there he goes. Oh, he came to life. He's not as tired as I thought. He was just kind of swimming along the surface. Very nice. Yeah. Whoop. Man, he wanted that fly. I wanted to let him go, but I think we're gonna keep that one. He's all hooked up in the gills. There we go. Look at that beautiful fish. Nice rainbow. One little mark there, one little sore on him from copepods. But that's a nice fish. It's probably 15, 16 inches or so. Just a beauty. And couldn't resist that pink trolling fly. That trolling fly doesn't look too pretty right now. It looks pretty tore up, but looks great in the water. And he certainly liked it. So we'll get him in a bag and get him in the ice chest and get the fly back down to around 100 feet. And that's the pattern right now. So anyway, I can't complain. Not an easy bite out here. Got some wind. It's been a little difficult, but overall, man, I'm catching fish. The flies are working. Howdy, folks. Kel Kellogg here. Well, it's chilly this morning. I got my jacket on. Fall is in the air in the Sierra foothills, and when fall is in the air, it's the time to start thinking about trolling flies for trout. That trout you saw me catch in the opening was caught on this pink and white marabou fly right here. It presses all the buttons for rainbows. It's got that dark over light coloration. It's got some crystal flash in it. It's got big prominent eyes. So that fly is just a winner. But one of the things that kind of comes up surrounding trolling flies, and I've had several questions this week. Folks here on the channel are really, really getting into the whole trolling fly concept. But they've been asking me things like, you know, what depth are they most effective at? How do you rig them? How do you use them? And I've got some advanced rigging I'm going to go over in a future video. But let's talk about the basics here today. Most of the time, I like to run trolling flies as a shallow water presentation, but they're not just a shallow water bait. That trout you saw me catch in the opening, that fish was holding at 101 feet. And I was trolling this fly right here, teamed with a wiggle disc right there. I was running the disc right on the nose of the fly right there. Now typically, I'll rig flies like this on 8 or 10 pound test fluorocarbon, and between the wiggle disc and the fly, I'll put one of those little rubber bobber stops. So what that allows me to do is move the disc up and down the line to affect the action. If I want a subtler action or if I want to troll faster, I'll create some space. If I want maximum vibration and action at a lower speed, I'll run that disc right on the nose of the fly. I would say 80% of the time I'm running that disc either on the nose of the fly or within about probably 3/4 of an inch. Now, I was running that off a downrigger, like you'd run any other lure. I was trolling at about 1.8 to 2 miles an hour. The fish were, you know, they were stacked up. They were feeding on shad. The fly wasn't the best presentation at Shasta last week. Smaller stuff was actually working better for numbers. I caught a number of fish on my shad tubes. I caught a number of fish on smaller spoons, eighth-ounce humdingers and stuff like that. The three biggest fish of the trip all came on the trolling fly, however. So, once again, it just reinforces in my mind that trolling flies are a great big fish bait. Now, going into the fall, we're not going to have to be using the downriggers as much. So I'll be running these flies either off a lead core or running them right under the surface. When I top line a fly like this, I use the wiggle disc. I'll use a 48-inch fluorocarbon leader going up to a trolling swivel, and I'll just clamp on a single split shot. And that puts me down, you know, at 100 feet back in my kayak, I might be down a foot or two. That's how I caught that big 7-pound rainbow last October at Lake Elmanor. I mean, that fly was right under the surface, and when that fish hit, I mean, he took one hard run and he was just instantly airborne, instantly on the surface. In general, I like to put the fly over the top of where I think the fish are gonna be, because I want them to look up and see the fly silhouetted against the sky, or, you know, in deep water, against the light up above them. I want them to look up, see the fly, go up, grab it, turn on it, and take it. Another question I get a lot about flies is, do you always have to team them with the wiggle disc? And the answer to that is no. I was watching my dad 25 years ago put on a number two woolly booger. He would put that on, he would do a short leader, he would put on an egg weight, and he would just troll that thing, and it had no action, and he would catch a lot of fish on it. So if you want to go real subtle, get rid of the wiggle disc altogether. Just troll the fly. Presentation looks horrible. I'm warning you beforehand. It just looks like a straight fly going through the water with no action. Sometimes it's dynamite. At other times, you might want to team your flies with a dodger. Think of them as just like you'd rig a hoochie, or you'd rig a tube, anything like that. You might want to rig them, you know, deep water. Rig them with a 6-inch sling blade like this, a UV sling blade. Scope that fly back 2 or 3 dodger links. The dodger is going to give the fly plenty of stop and start action, just like you would a hoochie. That can be very effective. Other thing I've been playing with for near surface presentations is this Max Double D Dodger. And what's unique about this dodger, you see all those holes? There's a series of holes here. Well, if you run the attached swivel in the middle, it's going to run straight behind the boat, okay? If you start putting it in these holes over here, the dodger's going to run out to the side of the boat. So you're going to get a little bit of a side planer effect. If you put one of these on, put a fly behind it, use one of the extreme left or right holes, depending on what side of the boat or kayak you want to fish, and scope it back, say, 100 feet, you're going to be about 8 to 10 feet deep. You're going to have a lot of flash and a lot of vibration from the dodger, and you're going to get that side planer effect. So you're going to be out over there. So no lead cord necessary, no weight necessary. You're going to be up in the top 10 feet of the water column. A lot of flash, a lot of vibration. And you can run that fly within a couple dodger links, or you could scope it out there 36 inches and still use your wiggle disc as well. So that's a very versatile presentation, very versatile blade from Max. I think these things are kind of under-publicized. Not a lot of guys are using them. They're very unique, and I'm just getting started playing with these. So they're pretty dang cool. They come in a whole bunch of different colors, but I really like that side planer effect. If for nothing else, I mean, my footprint in the kayak is pretty small. It's pretty subtle. I'm not scaring a lot of fish, but it's still nice to get my lines spread apart. It definitely, you know, helps with tangles and stuff like that. And yes, I don't often show it on camera, but I tangle up just as much as anybody, probably more than some folks. But having the ability to spread lines, have one line going straight back and one line scoped out to the side, definitely helps you cover more water, helps you avoid tangles. And if you're fishing out of a power boat, you know, like my Duckworth or whatever, it does help get the bait out of the footprint of the boat. It's very important when you're working shallow water, and that's what we're going to be working this fall. Yes, we'll be doing some downrigger fishing for sure, but most of the fish, when the water temperature gets 60 degrees or less on the surface, you can count on those rainbows being up top. They're going to be up cruising the surface. That's where you want to catch them. Top lines, shallow presentations, that's the way to go. So that's kind of my notes on my that's fly trolling 101 for me. I'm gonna be back with some more advanced tactics probably later this week. If you are interested in getting your hands on one of my complete sets of flies, 10 flies, nice compartment box, and 3 wiggle discs, click on over to the store. We've got, I don't know, we've got a few dozen kits available. I'm gonna try to order more, but they come and go quickly. But if you wanna get your hands on some dandy flies for the fall season, click on over to the store, check out our flies and our full line of tackle. Anyway, I'm Cal Kellogg. You guys have a great Monday. I'm jumping off. I got a few chores to do. I gotta run to town. I got a little bit of work to do on the Suburban because this week, I'm going to Davis. Not sure which day I'm going, but I'm going to Davis and I'm going to trade punches with some big old rainbows, and you know I'm going to be trolling flies. So anyway, I will catch you next time right here on YouTube, folks. Thanks for all the support. If you haven't hit the subscribe button, please hit subscribe. And remember, if it wasn't for you folks, we wouldn't have a Fish Hunt Shoot YouTube channel. Get some flies. Get after those big trout. Catch you later.